week, we had the clearest sign yet of looming apocalyptic Armageddon. The Pew Research Center released a new study this week finding that women are the sole or primary breadwinners in 40% of American households with children.
Take cover.
No, seriously, if that doesn't sound like rapture-producing eschatological finding to you, well, then you haven't been watching the Fox Business Channel and their all-man panel.
We're watching society dissolve around us, Juan. What do you think?
You're seeing the disintegration of marriage, something going terribly wrong in American society, and it's hurting our children.
And those are the children who survived 54 million abortions since Roe v. Wade.
And when you look at biology, look at the natural world, the roles of a male and a female in society and other animals, the male typically is the dominant role.
This is a catastrophic issue, and sadly, no one on the left, right, or center is dealing with the breakdown of family structure. We're losing a generation. Bottom line, it could undermine our social order.
Okay, so here with me once again, our personal finance expert, Carmen Wong Ulrich, Business Insider's Josh Barrow, who's going to answer for all men.
Yes.
The Griots, Joy Reid, and joining the table now also, candidate for New York City's public advocate, Reshma Soojani. Okay. I feel like I do want to start with you, Josh.
Okay.
What is wrong with y'all?
I can't answer for Fox Business. What I see actually, there is part of this story is totally fine. There actually are a couple of alarming undercurrents to this. One of which is that over the last 30 years, men have not been keeping up with economic shifts. You've had this job polarization where middle school skill jobs are falling out. Sure. We have more high skill and low skill jobs, and women have responded to that by greatly increasing their level of educational attainment over the last 30 years. Men haven't, and so they've had decreased attachment to the workforce. More of them are working in low skill jobs, and that's one of the reasons that you have more households with women as primary breadwinners. So that, I think, is in part not a happy story because it's about men not keeping up. But I think this idea that the biological frame that's been put on it is
well,
very
and,
odd.
And even yeah. less whether or not men are keeping up, the idea that a household isn't keeping up, right? That we now live in a country where to live at a standard that my grandparents may have been able to do on one income, you simply must have two incomes.
That's the most dangerous point, that now we think that dual income is natural and that's the way we should rule our lives. The problem is it's actually the most fragile position to be in. Because if you basically base an income off of two, or base your whole household off of two, you lose one. That's 50%
pay cut. And you can lose that one from divorce, but you can also lose them from illness.
Anything,
you could lose them from accident, any of those vulnerabilities.
But I love what you just said about men taking responsibility, because what we just saw was absolutely no responsibility for the breakdown of households and American households, that men really haven't kept up. You have. But men in general have not kept up. But that's the trouble, because we also see that in the households, the breadwinning households too, which we'll talk about later, women being overburdened by all the responsibility.
But at the same time too, there's also that cultural component because of course it is Fox, so it is conservatism. And I think my new slogan for the Fox Business Network, which I'm going to write for them right now, is Fox Business, woman, have baby, make sandwich.
Oh, yes.
That should be their slogan, right?
Have
because
baby,
it's
make
also
sandwich.
That too.
Have baby, make
have
sandwich.
Have baby,
breeze.
Make sandwich.
Sandwich.
Right. No, yes. And the thing is that because I believe that what we're seeing there is a lot of men reacting to the cultural shift of men not being dominant, period.
Mm-hmm.
And this idea that underlies conservatism, with the consent of conservative women, which is what is required to make that work, is that you have to give men the dominant role in society such that women typically stay not as competitors in the workforce. And I think that since Roe v. Wade, the idea that women have sort of autonomy over their bodies, the idea that women are going into the workforce, not out of necessity, but sometimes because they want to, is really threatening to a lot of conservative men who don't want to compete with women in the workforce, number one, and who definitely don't want to work for women in the workforce.
Yeah. Just to add to that, too, I thought that was all about good old boy privilege,
right?
I mean, the fact that we are now the majority in the voting booth and we are the majority in college, we are the majority in the labor force, right? And that is threatening to them. The thing, though, I think that you raised that I wanted to bring up in the Pew study that was disturbing was how much single mothers are making. Right? We're focused, we should be focused on low-income women, right, minority women and immigrant women who are still not able to kind of have good-paying jobs and to lift their families forward. And that's the conversation we
and
should
one
be
out of six
and first of all, I think this is, we were talking about the bimodal distribution around the economy in general, and we really saw that in these Pew data, right? That on the one hand, you do have women with very good educations who are often married, who are working in upper income jobs, right? 83,000 plus. And they're working largely often because they want to, and they want to work these jobs because they're fulfilling and they're well paid. And then you have women single moms who were working at the $20,000 wage,
right,
who very well may have a preference for staying home and providing for the emotional nurturing care of their kids, but have absolutely, right? And those are two different sets of, you know, so-called choice sets, right, that women are facing.
And I'm sure those Republican men are not willing to put the resources in to make sure that they can actually stay home and take care of their
kids.
Exactly.
Those women should work, because now there's that sort of dual mindset, right, among the right, which they're saying that women like the ones you described that are lower income, that are working because they have to, well, they need to be responsible. They're the ones who need to, if they want to get public assistance, they better work for it.
I'm just saying, it's not just a cultural question, it's a public policy.
Exactly.
Like, you can't get, you cannot get what you need.
And if you have those babies, those 65 million
which
babies,
you must have,
which he brings up, and then they want you to have them. They don't want to have to support them, or the parents.
Yes, that's right. So when we come back, they
recognize that having moms as the primary breadwinner is bad for kids and bad for marriage.
But let's be clear, not everyone over there at the other network is quite so backward. The women of Fox very quickly stepped up to school their male colleagues on the ways of the world. Here is Greta Van Susteren writing on her blog after the segment. Have these men lost their minds? Are these my colleagues? Oh, brother. Maybe I need to have a little chat with them. Next thing, they will have a segment to discuss eliminating women's right to vote. And having that little chat on the air was Fox News' Megyn Kelly, who yesterday called into Lou Dobbs and Eric Erickson to explain themselves.
American Psychological Association 2010 study, according to a review of 50 years of research, children whose mothers work are no more likely to have any problems than kids whose mothers stay at home. They studied 69 studies over 59 years of research. Your fact and your science, Eric, is not supported by the American Psychological Association, the American Academy of Pediatrics, Columbia University study, University of North Carolina study. I mean, why are we supposed to take your word for it? Eric Erickson's science instead of all of these
You are not going to see this often, but go, Megyn! All right, which brings me to a point I really want to make about how important it is to have women in power. You see, even if we have disagreement on ideological questions, women as breadwinners, but also as business leaders, as Fox News hosts, as elected officials, women on the right, on the left, in the middle, they often try to fight for things that men in all of these places have ignored for decades. Now, it's not universal. You're always going to have the Margaret Thatchers and the Michelle Bachmans, whose politics are not only far from feminist, but also not particularly women-centered. But women are more likely to ask questions like, for example, how do we make it possible for parents, both men and women, to both work and take good care of their children? Something that's ironic about the Fox News men, and really conservatives in general, is that they often espouse things like traditional family values and women staying at home with their children as essential to our social fabric, but at the same time, they fight tooth and nail against any policy that would allow women, especially poor women, to do just that. These are the same people that say parents on welfare, including single mothers of young children, must work, definitely not stay at home with their children. And Eric Erickson is certainly not about to call for government-subsidized affordable child care or raising the minimum wage or offering parental sick leave. Neither is John Boehner. So let's talk about women in power and what it means for women and really for families as a whole. Back with me, finance expert and working mom, Carmen Wong Ulrich, politics editor for Business Insider, Josh Barrow, holding it down for the guys at the table, Joy Reid, managing editor of thegrio.com, and also a working mom, and Reshma Sunjathi, who is the founder of Girls Who Code and a candidate for New York City public advocate. So, Reshma, I wanted to ask you, because you say that you are actually running as a woman.
Oh, absolutely.
What does that mean?
Unabashedly. You know, when I talk about my four pillars as I'm running for public advocate, one of them is women, right? We as a city will not be as strong as we can be unless we uplift women.
Yep.
And that means fighting for paid parental leave. It means creating incentives for corporations to have daycare centers on site. Mm-hmm. It means increasing tax credits for childcare, which we have not done in over a decade.
Yep.
Like, we can't make it possible for women to work and have children unless we change structures. I mean, the FMLA was passed in 1993, 20 years ago.
No, right?
20 years ago. And the thing is that's really amazing, right, is I can say that as a female candidate. And you couldn't say that a couple years ago. It's uplifting. And women get riled up. They are fired up after 2000.
It was pretty extraordinary to see Megyn Kelly there. I mean, I must say, there are people on my network who sometimes say things that I deeply disagree with, and I just kind of go on and do my show the next day. For her to actually take on the men on her network, I mean, that That is incredibly courageous, and she did it pretty darn well there.
She did a great job. Watching the women of Fox rise up and stand up for womanhood is the most
great.
Amazing and awesome thing in the world. I agree with you. Go Megyn Kelly. And actually, hearing facts quoted on Fox threw me off a little.
She's got science too on Fox News.
But I mean, it's true, and I think that the important thing that Rush said is that it has to be not about women with nannies. Because women with nannies are going to be okay.
Right.
Women with nannies have choices. But the women,
it's about the nannies.
It's about the nannies. Exactly. And it's about the women who do need structural policy still from the government, which only the government can do, that make it possible for them to have to work, but also have full lives. Because you know what? Women do want to stay home with their kids who are not rich. Women, there are women who want to make the choice and have the option to have some parental leave. I know people who've
gone back to stay home for a year.
Make,
you know, I mean, it's not as though these are totalizing life decisions, right? It 6 weeks is barely enough time to feel human again, right?
Exactly.
Particularly after certain kinds of giving birth.
Sure.
But if you had 6 months, if you had a year, you might be fully ready to go back.
That's right.
And by the way, also men might be the ones
and
who want to pick up that second
year. To bring about the scientific side of all of this, because I've seen way too many men use this whole scientific research shows and all of this. Here's the thing. The real issue is that there are differences between groups that are just as equal as the differences within groups.
Sure.
Now, that's a basic tenet of social science. Everybody knows that. So I can find you a stupid male traitor who will lose out to a just-had-a-baby fantastic female trader.
Yep.
And when we have hedge fund managers, when we have all these folks saying that this is scientifically based, I'm telling you that you can find stupid guys and you can find stupid ladies and great guys and great ladies. It's nothing to do with whether there's a baby at your bosom, which they actually talk about. It has to do with the person. So if we can go to the table as a person, as opposed to just a woman who they feel are somehow crippled by hormones or whatever, that we can have that chance to prove it. And the fact that you have two women that worked for you who had a baby and left or got stupid or does not speak for all of us.
Look, I think part of what's interesting, though, in what you're saying around this question of sort of women standing in for the whole group. We saw this with Michelle Bachmann, right?
Yes.
And Michelle Bachmann making a choice to step down as a member of Congress and not to run for re-election. I am no fan of Michelle Bachmann's policies, but I have been consistently irritated with the kind of representation of her as vacant, as dumb, as incapable, as an incompetent, and because it feels gendered, right? Because the House is full of dumb men, and we just don't represent them as somehow indicative of the entire gender in that way.
Yeah, well, I think I don't think she was that often represented as vacant and dumb. I see a contrast between her and Sarah Palin, who I think absolutely did get that representation, in part because I think it's sort of true of Sarah Palin. But Bachmann, it was always clear that she had something going on upstairs. She's a crazy person, but
she did one thing that a member of Congress has to do.
Yeah.
That is, she got reelected over and over again, right?
Just barely. I mean, she won by 1 point in a district that Mitt Romney carried by 14 points in 2012.
Yep.
So she was, you know, she was clearly a weak candidate because she was so far out there. What I loved about that Megyn Kelly interview with Eric Erickson was the way that she really went to the science on that, because Erickson did this thing that you always see when someone is defending some sort of traditional gender role where they're saying, well, it's, you know, it's not that it's my religious view or that it's some, you know, internal bias. This is what the science says.
Animals. And they bring up the same thing with gay marriage. They bring up animals. And here's the thing. There is absolute evidence with animals of matriarchies, where the women rule, and also of homosexuality.
Well, have you ever watched Natural Geographic? I mean, it's the lioness who hunts.
Right. But can I also just take a moment to pause to kind of marvel at watching a predominantly sort of white conservative movement react in horror to a societal norm, that something that has been a societal norm for the African-American community for a really long time. Which is that you did have a lot of women who had an easier time getting into the workforce than black men. I mean, black men have had a comparatively more difficult time breaking into high levels of corporate America, getting higher education. And so for African-American families, having a woman in that role was actually is nothing new. But watching it happen now, I think in the larger society, there's a reaction of just horror because they're tying immediately that all these social pathologies are going to follow, that you're going to have out of wedlock birth and you're going to have poverty and all these
other
things.
And to answer this, this is some of the work I do with Girls Who Code. You know, I started a nonprofit to teach teenage girls how to computer program. And for forever, we've been telling girls that math and science is too hard for you.
Right.
So people,
math is
you're just
hard.
Not going to be good at it.
Yeah.
And now, you can make $83,000 as a website programmer. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, these are the middle class jobs. There's 1.4 million of them out there. Less than 20% of women are going into it. And let's not even talk about women of color.
Yep.
Right? And so I do think it's like really fighting against these systems and these structures that are set up against women and girls.
Yep.
And that's what that panel was about. That's why you got to have more women running for office. That's why we got
to
make sure that we're constantly educating our
and
girls.
We need men's
standing
help to do
up
this.
And putting resources towards women and
girls.
We
need more men's help as soon as we come back, because I do want to talk more.